Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we are here with Professor C.P. Chandrasekhar to look into the Punjab National Bank issue. By now everybody knows the details of the fraud that has taken place in PNB of 11,000 crores. But what the news or the news analysis is not going into is what is the reason for this crisis. Some people say that it is a technical problem of integrating SWIFT to the core banking system. Other people say it's a problem of internal checks and balances or the problems of audit. But what really is the problem? Let us discuss today. Hello, sir.
What we have is a situation in which a group of companies, led of course by Nirav Modi and Choksi, are in a position to be able to get letters of undertaking, which allows them to access credit from banks outside the country without any collateral, when the requirement is that normally the collateral has to be complete because this is associated with purchases and imports into the country or some activity of that kind. So they get it without collateral. They get not one, but they get multiple ones, and they get a significantly large number of ones, it appears, from what one reads, within a very short period of time. The third is that they not only get this, but these are consistently repeated. So periodically they've sort of renewed because they're short term, so that this allows short term credit to be transformed into long term credit. It obviously means that the banks to which the LOUs were being provided were willing to continue to keep offering this credit because they were the ones who were in the final analysis providing the credit abroad. So they should have been in the know that this process is going on. And of course there are, what you mentioned, there are the SWIFT transactions, which is supposed to be a transaction which has layered checks, and therefore it's unlikely that such a large volume of transactions would have gone unnoticed. So put all of this together and it's a bit difficult to actually say that just because there was no integration of SWIFT with core banking, this thing went unnoticed for years together, and therefore we had this large accumulation of what is undoubtedly a huge sum as far as the scam is concerned. According to a reply which was given in Parliament to a question which was raised by one of the MPs in the Rajya Sabha, that if you take the average, the annual average of frauds, of the total frauds of all scheduled commercial banks in the period leading up to March 2017, 4 years leading up to March 2017, the average is in the range of about 14,500, between 14,500 and 15,000 crores. So you can actually see that this one incident is equivalent to what is an annual, almost, and what is equivalent to an annual average. And that annual average itself is a significant step up. If you go back to a sort of speech which Chakravarti, who was the deputy governor of the Reserve Bank, gave, we actually find that in the 4 years ending 2012-13, which was the previous 4 years, if you take the average, it was much less. It was in the range of about, 7,000, 8,000 crores or so. So what we're observing is that in recent years, particularly over the last 4 or 5 years, there's been a huge buildup in the volume of scams in the banking system, frauds in the banking system. Leading, of course, to different degrees of write-off, because we must admit this much, that fraud is inevitable in banking in as much as human beings are complex. But the point is, a bank's role is to try and work to ensure that the number of these frauds and the volume involved is less, and also to work to ensure that once detected, you should be in a position to be able to recover as much as possible. As I said, we can't just reduce this to a situation in which we say it's because of lack of linking, because there were so many points and locations and so many agents who should have had some information. And so the idea that you would not be able to detect that something is odd, even if you didn't think it was a fraud or that it was a fraudulent transaction, that there's something odd going on, should have been visible and should have been detected, particularly given the long period for which it has lasted. So what I think we need to do is to try and place this in the context of a whole change of the environment in which public sector banking is forced to function. And I think we need to dissociate two components of that environment. One component of that environment comes from the changed sort of financial and economic and financial situation which comes with liberalization. And the second component of it comes from the sort of the changed policy thrust of the government itself. I mean, very clearly, as far as the government is concerned, being business friendly, and by business friendly we don't mean all businesses, being big business friendly, which is sort of concealed or, you know, put behind this motto of saying that we want to improve the ease of doing business. So the whole idea is, if you go up in a few ranks in the ease of doing business scale, however good that measure is, that's considered to be a big achievement. And to do that, you're in a real sense, you're willing to go out of your way to try and provide concessions. These concessions could be land and resources provided cheap. These concessions could be tax concessions. And of course, these could also be concessions of a kind in which you actually say that we'll reach you the credit to undertake the activities which we'd like you to undertake. So it might be infrastructural projects, it might be, you know, sort of prestige clients who are supposed to be champions, in national champions in the world of business. I mean, we can back somebody wanting to take over Chorus and make it into a national battle with a Brazilian firm. We can back somebody who's seen as now emerging as one of the, you know, the top diamond merchants of the world, and not just diamond merchant, but a diamond designer who, you know, hobnobs with the elite, has some of the best brand ambassadors possible, etc. So these are presented as these national champions who reflect where India is. Now, if you move into a situation of that kind, and you have these two components, where the state is going to back these kinds of, as I call them, you know, these sort of perceived champions, and you're in a situation of financial liberalization. In a situation of financial liberalization, we know what really happened is banks were flush with funds because of the liquidity which was injected into the system, given the large inflows of capital. They were under pressure to lend. And the way they basically saw it is that if these were the entities which were being backed, and of course, I'm sure there was pressure from different sections of the state, that you no more are functioning like a public sector bank used to function in an earlier period, when it was not profitability which was the consideration. What was the consideration was the degree to which you met certain social banking targets which were set for you. So we've seen that transformation, which basically means that, listen, the issue is not just ownership. The issue is if the state which owns you has itself transformed the way in which it visualizes what should be the role of banking and wants to use it as an instrumentality for promoting big business, then you create an environment in which banks flush with funds then decide that these are prestige clients placing a bet on, which is good because they seem to be doing well. They seem to be having the backing of the state, and they seem to be in areas which they claim are growing, etc. So we saw two kinds of things. One, of course, we saw that this resulted in the provision of huge loans to projects which should not have been funded. So what's really happening is that instead of due diligence and proper appraisal of projects, things like the prestige of the client, the size of the loan, the extent of state backing for the client, these things become more important in loan decision making than actually looking at the nitty-gritty. Of course, you look at it, but you actually are far more lenient because of the fact that these are the kind of entities you have. So we had a set of loans, large loans, which went to projects which wouldn't have been funded, and the result of that we are seeing now. Once you actually began to demand, or the central bank began to demand recognition of, and better recognition of non-performing assets, you have this huge spike in NPAs. As the rules get tighter, the spike is expected to increase far more. So we are in a situation in which you have this huge NPA burden, and a large part of it, some 70% or 80% incrementally, is due to these large corporate borrowers who have been backed as part of this liberalization policy. And I think the other component of that is, when you're in an environment of that kind, then it becomes very much easier for people, on the basis of this prestige, of the fact that they've got the backing, etc., to get loans for things which are not even projects which really are worth funding. I mean, they're getting loans. We don't even know whether the implicit or explicit specification of why this loan was being taken and the guarantee being provided was actually met. Was that money being used for this purpose? Was it being used to just set up these fancy, stores in the most expensive real estate in all the top metropolitan cities of the world? You know, was it actually being squandered in that fashion and to a certain extent? So the whole relationship between the banking system and these prestige clients becomes very unequal in favor of the client. And, you know, that creates this environment. Now, in this, really, the reason why these people have that strength is because of the support which comes from, you know, varied levels. It comes from the state, possibly right from the Prime Minister's office in the case of some of them. It comes, of course, from the top management of the banks, who think that, you know, that this is what they should do, given the state's perception and given the fact that they're public sector managers. And this goes down, and it goes down to, you know, officers who are responsible for implementing all of this. And maybe some of them didn't even see any payoff they got as something which was what was responsible for them doing what they did. It almost like getting a bonus for what you would have anyway otherwise done, you know, because that was the environment. So the way I see it is that, as I said, you know, fraud is not something which is completely avoidable in a market economy, even with public banking. There would be some fraud and losses due to fraud. These are operational risks. You need to provide for them. You try to reduce them and you try to recover as much as possible. But what we are actually observing is a spike in the volume of each of the frauds involved, and therefore the value of total frauds which the banking system is going to carry. And I think that comes from this environment of this combination of financial liberalization plus a sort of obsession on the part of this government to identify itself as being the most reformist, within inverted commas, which India has ever seen. And that leads to the NPAs, as you put it, on one side, and it leads to the possibilities of fraud of this kind. And therefore, I don't think this is going to be the last we'll hear. In any case, already there's another one which has come up. All of them start with small sums, and then the sum involved keeps increasing. So I see it as a systemic problem. This is systemic fraud of a kind, which comes from an environment in which you have a certain policy and a certain kind of aggressive state. What is also reflective of this sort of systemic thing is the bank managements want to say that, oh, it's an isolated problem in a couple of branches and a few officials. The finance ministry want to say that the central bank wants to say that it's a failure of internal systems and scrutiny. The finance ministry wants to say, no, it's also a failure, you know, Arvind Subramaniam goes and says, it's also a failure of the regulatory authority, which is the central bank. So, you know, and so everybody actually wants to pass the buck and say that, you know, this is, so, So the easiest thing is to find a fall guy and say that, oh, you know, these are public sector. And, you know, ASSOCHAM has already said that, you know, this is a case for privatization, which is absurd. I mean, you know, this is a case for changing. Of course, you need to ensure that guidelines which already exist and need to be implemented of due diligence, prudential regulation, etc., must continue. But the point is, we also need to see how an environment, a larger neoliberal environment of this kind, is completely dangerous for a banking system. And which is why I think we have to place both together, the non-performing assets, which is not a case of pure fraud. I mean, that is a case of bad decision making coming from the fact that you're getting a banking sector which is backing ports, roads, civil aviation, steel, you know, obviously if you go in for these kinds of projects, there's likelihood that you'll have an NPAs very, a large NPAs very high. So I think that's the way I'd like to look at it.
From what you're saying, I get the sense that as long as the policies of liberalization and as long as state is not really investing on its own, this problem might continue.
Yeah, the way I'd put it is that let's keep fraud aside for a moment. But even if, for example, you say that I'm going to put so much money and recapitalize the banks so that whatever haircut they are required to take, I'll be able to clean their books, put the balance sheet back in shape, ensure the capital adequacy norms, not that we need to at all meet those Basel norms. There's no treaty there. Most international banks think twice before they get there. But anyway, assuming you do all this, and then you have a next round, you know, and you have a next round of NPAs beginning to come, and you know, then what? You're going to go for a... Now, what the government initially did, because it thought that it had sorted the problem out between 1991 and round about 2004-05, because you had a collapse in the ratio of non-performing assets to gross advances. But we now know that after that, they hid behind the stressed assets definition a lot of the non-performing assets which came because of the new lending associated with liberalization. And that's now risen. So supposing you clear this up, what's the guarantee that, and there is no guarantee, in fact, it will happen. You'll actually have once again an increase in the NPA volume. And I do think what the government is, you know, thought in this round, they thought that they could actually sort the problem out by setting up asset reconstruction companies, going in for some disinvestment of equity in public sector banks, maybe use the occasion to actually reduce, you know, public holding below 52% by changes in laws, and you know, and then go for some disinvestment, which is actually privatization, and then use that money. But obviously what they realized is, who's going to buy all of this equity if the banks are burdened with all of these NPAs, you know? So then first there was all these ideas, how do you take these NPAs out and dump it in some bad banks which the government will own, and you then sell off these other entities. But that wasn't working, so they've gone for this, you know, this 1.2 lakh crore recapitalization exercise. And the way I see it is that the way it's being presented is, this is the last time you're going to do it. Now, if you say this is the last time you're going to do it, but you're not changing the policy environment which generates large NPAs, then next time around, what's going to happen? So you basically are trying to say that, okay, I'm going to get into a situation where I've wiped the books clean. Now, please, I'm going to let you go and, you know, disinvest and privatize yourself. And then it's the private party's decision. We'll change the rules. We won't put any... You know, we won't put any pressures on you. You function as you are. But it's not that private banks don't fail. I mean, you know, in 2007-08, it's private banks which are failing. And the government had nationalized them in countries where there wasn't public banking. So I basically think that all this FRDI and so on, this whole resolution authority, this whole idea of trying to say that we should have bail-ins and not bail-outs, is trying to create a situation where private operators will say that, okay, now the books are clean, we can take these people over, we'll have a certain degree of freedom to function the way we want because the state will change the rules, and we are going to be given new ways of socializing losses, including through depositors, you know, to say that, you know, anybody who, you know, who's actually a creditor to the bank, which a depositor is, in is, you know, partly taking a risk and therefore has to be responsible. So you say up to, you know, whatever, 1 lakh or whatever it is, you have deposit insurance. Beyond that, you take a haircut too, which is basically giving those who will be holding the bank, either the state if it continues to hold it or the private sector, a way of actually socializing losses, so that you're actually, all of this seems to be a way of, you know, creating this environment where you can hand over a public banking system to the private sector, and that will give control over the nation's savings to the private sector. And therefore, this attack which is coming, saying this is all public banks and that's why we are having all this fraud and so on, is I think, part of that larger agenda and exercise.
Finally, just one more question. Does it make sense for public sector banks to reorient their credit in the sense, maybe do more like private sector banks into consumer credit and the kind of credit that private banks do?
You know, the way I would look at it is, they are under pressure to lend. If you have the increase in deposits, which we saw, and deposits you can take it relative to the size of the economy, to GDP, and look at the deposits to GDP ratio, it just spiked hugely after 2004 because there was so much capital coming into the country, creating liquidity in the system. And banks can't sit on liquidity, you know, so because they're paying depositors interest, so they have to earn something. So they did diversify into retail banking, and from something like, if I remember the figures, you know, maybe 7-8%, it went up to almost a quarter of total advances, which is quite a lot. And other than, really other than for, most of it of course went for housing, but if you look at the distribution of non-performing assets, other than for educational loans, which of course because of the job market being what it is, you know, we are beginning to see significant defaults. It hasn't performed, I mean, they haven't performed badly at all in the retail market, despite the fact that there were apprehensions. But that's because they stopped at 23 or 24%. But if you actually keep on bringing in more and more people because you want to expand this, so there has to be a way in which these entities should be able to buy into bonds, etc., of specialized financial institutions, which have government and central bank backing, which can finance all these capital intensive projects, because we do need to finance those projects. But the banks at least will be putting their monies, besides lending to some investment projects, would also be generating a portfolio, given the large volume of deposits, in which they can have a higher degree of safety with this perhaps a slightly better rate of interest than what they get on government securities today. But even government securities is not too bad, you know. So given all of that, I think that it's that unless you get rid of the push on the public banking system to use the liquidity it has to do things which the state thinks should be done, it should be done through the private sector, and it won't be done by the state because they believe in all their, you know, fiscal consolidation conservatism, which is not warranted to the extent that they've gone. And therefore, you end up with creating this position. You must be able to break the public banking system out of that, give it a larger portfolio. But just going more and more into retail might not be the answer, because they have diversified in favor of retail, maybe a little more. But finally, I do think it will have to be a situation in which they might be the port of call of these savings. But when the savings actually gets allocated in terms of the risk which is taken, there must be state-sponsored or state-owned entities as intermediaries in between who carry the risks and give a decent return, such that the banking system, which has many other, you know, social functions and externalities, would not be put under the stress.
Thank you, Professor Chandrasekhar. We hope to get back to you on this issue again.